There was something else I was supposed to say. Anyway, last Sunday night we were getting into this series on lessons from the life of Jesus, or about Jesus particularly, and we did a really quick submitting of ideas of if you were developing a list of seven things everyone should know about Jesus, and I asked you to put down one of those seven, and I had a whole stack of papers there. Didn't really know what to do with them, but I just tabulated them. I took the key idea off of each one, and some had more than one idea. Now, I wasn't going to double count those in several categories, but just took key idea off of each one, and I thought I would share the results with you tonight. It does two things, I think. The ones that were mentioned the most often that tells us that these are generally thought to be the most important, and there will be no surprises there, but it was good in our answers that we reaffirmed that these are really the things that we think are most important. And then some others were only mentioned maybe once or twice, but that also shows us something of the variety of ideas of things that we can consider important about Jesus. So here's pretty much the results. Son of God, 23 times. Died for our sins 20 times. Those were the two major responses. 13 times, he is the only Savior, or the Savior, or something of that nature. 10 times, something about he loves us, and he died because of his love for us. 6 times, he was resurrected. 4 times, he is God in the flesh. And then the rest of these were mentioned once. Unlike any other man, he is our high priest. His body is the church. He is forgiving. He is the reconciler. He submitted to his Father's will. He did great miracles. He is the fulfillment of prophecy. He touches all areas of our lives. And he has all authority. A good collection there of important things that we know and that we think others should know about Jesus. In every person's life, there are key moments, major events, turning points, whatever you want to call them. For some of these events, you know at the time of the event, at the time of the decision, that this will have a major impact on your life from that day forward. But sometimes we think something is a major event, it turns out to be something of a dud. It really didn't make all that much difference in our lives. Others, at the time of the event, we didn't notice that this was a significant moment or change or decision in our lives. And only later, as we look back, we see that this was maybe a defining moment in our life. Of course, there are those moments that remain forever a mystery, but were significant, even though for us they were hidden. You were at an intersection. You decide to turn left and then turn right to go to your destination. You could have gone straight forward and then turn left, gotten to the same place. What you don't know, and you will never know, is that if you had gone straight, you would have been in a major accident that would have turned your life upside down. Those are the things that we will never know about, the infinite what-ifs of life. But there are these major events that either at the time of the event or later, we know and we're aware, we recognize that these were life-altering moments. Some are more significant than others, but they all had an impact. Just as examples, let me bore you for a moment with a few of my life events that I know now, at least, were turning points. Birth was pretty big. I wasn't aware at the time just how big that was, but it had a major impact on the rest of my life. And of course, then you could also factor in other aspects of that and the surrounding factors, the family into which I was born, where I was born, town, country, state, whatever, the faith of the parents to whom I was born. Those are major factors. Again, at the time, totally oblivious to them, but they had a major impact. All kinds of things that created a context that set an initial direction for a person's life. I look at my arrival as a freshman at Harding, then Harding College, as a major turning point in my life. There were, of course, the things like the academics and choice of a major and things like that. But the thing that I see as having had the greatest influence on me in my life was the four guys with whom I was assigned to share a two-room dorm suite. I was only 17 at the time. Definitely immature, influenceable. Could have ended up with any number of different people and kinds of people, even at a Christian university. But by the grace of God, I was put in with four high-quality young Christian men. At that point in my life, they had a tremendous impact on the direction of my life. Wasn't aware of it at the time. At the time, we were just a bunch of freshmen having a good time. It was a defining moment. In some cases, these major turning points of life are not a single event, but they are a series of events that combine together to make a major turning moment of our lives. After my junior year of college, my sister talked me into going on a three-week mission trip to Belgium. She even paid part of my expenses as incentive to go ahead and go. On that trip, I met Jade. In the following months, several more things happened. I decided I want to return to Belgium as a long-term missionary. Jade and I decided to get married. I located a congregation to sponsor us and who gave me a job until I could find the necessary support. We got married and we moved to Belgium. All of that occurred in a span of about 19 months. And it was a life-changing, direction-setting series of events. Of course, there were many other things that happened, decisions that were made that had an impact. The birth of each of our sons, of course. Our decision to return to the United States after 22 years overseas. And the list goes on from really major to minor life-influencing events. The life of Jesus also had its turning points. We would probably agree that everything that happened in the life of Jesus was important. But even then, there were some things that were more important than others. Some were important because of the role that they played in God's plan of redemption. And those events and others were also important to Jesus on a personal level. Not just in the great plan of God, but to Jesus as a person, as a man. They meant something to him, and they determined the direction of his life. Now, we might struggle intellectually with questions about how much of the life of Jesus was predetermined according to God's big plan of redemption. But on a personal level, his life went where it went because of things that happened, or because of things that he did, or because of decisions that he made. And tonight we're going to take a look at a few of those events. And for some of them, it will again be a series of events that happened in such close proximity to each other that they created one major turning point in the life of Jesus. The beginning of the ministry of Jesus was a combination of at least three direction-setting events. And to keep from jumping around too much, for those of you who are trying to follow along in Scripture, I'm going to stay as much as possible in the Gospel of Luke. We won't be able to stay in Luke all the time. We'll be in John a little bit, but Luke and a little bit in John will cover at least most of the examples that I want to look at this evening. In Luke chapter 3, verse 21, Jesus came to John the Baptist to be baptized. It says, when all the people were baptized, it came to pass that Jesus also was baptized. And while he prayed, the heaven was open. Whether it is Jesus or one of us, the day of a person's baptism is a big day. But the impact it has on our lives from that day forward remains to be seen. It depends more on how we live after our baptism than the act of baptism itself. And I don't want to minimize at all the act of baptism, but we've known people who were baptized and didn't make any difference at all in the way their life was going. It depends on what we do with the commitment we have made at that time. But in the life of Jesus, his baptism marked a very precise moment and a clear, super important decision in his life. Jesus was, from this moment forward, fully engaged in the mission and the ministry that he had come to earth to do. The time of preparation was over. He was now moving the plan of God from the preparatory phase of John the Baptist to the phase of the Messiah. We also have here a case of the full impact of a decision not being fully realized until much later. Sometimes, for example, we may make a bad decision and years later it comes back to haunt us. Maybe we were arrested for some stupid thing we did in college. Just enough, you know, nothing bad, but enough to get it on our record. And then 20 years later, we can't get a job because we can't pass the background check because of that stupid mistake that is there still on our record. Or a good decision that turns out good later as well. In this case, it was definitely good. During the last week of the life of Jesus, the Jewish leaders confronted him and questioned him about the authority that he claimed to have. In Luke 20, verse 2, they spoke to him saying, "Tell us, by what authority are you doing these things? Or who is he who gave you this authority?" And Jesus answered by saying that he would answer their question if they would answer his question. He then asked them if they thought that John the Baptist was a prophet from God or not, if his baptism was from God or not. Luke 20, verses 5 and 6. They reasoned among themselves, saying, "If we say from heaven, he will say, 'Why then did you not believe him?' But if we say from men, all the people will stone us, for they are persuaded that John was a prophet." John was a prophet from God. And so if John said that people should be baptized, then people needed to be baptized. If Jesus had not been baptized by John, he would have been just as guilty as his opponents for not having followed the instructions of God's prophet. Even though, you know, these events were separated by about 3 years' time, it had an impact 3 years later. His baptism by John then opened the door for God to give him an affirmation of approval. The following verse, Luke 3:22, "And the Holy Spirit descended in bodily form like a dove upon him, and a voice came from heaven and said, 'You are my beloved Son, in you I am well pleased.'" Now this is an event for which on the personal level, we might underestimate the importance. Yes, this is a big event. Hey, people standing around heard a voice from God speaking. But it's easy for us to take the emotional needs of Jesus for granted. He's the Son of God. Actually, he's God in the flesh. He knew who he was. He knew what he was about. So he just came to earth and coolly, calmly did what a Messiah should do. We don't know much about what Jesus had been doing prior to that day, his baptism. But we know a lot about what was coming. We know the miracles were coming, and we know the teachings were coming, and we know the rejection is coming, and we know the crucifixion is coming. And he knew all that was coming too. That doesn't mean that it was easy for him when it came. So what son doesn't want to hear his father say, "You are my beloved son, and I'm pleased with you. You have stepped into the work that I sent you to do. Good job, son. You have started well. I am pleased." We cannot know how encouraging that moment was as Jesus began his ministry and how much strength it gave him to do what he had to do. The third phase of this three-part turning point was the temptation of Jesus, which followed very shortly after the baptism. In Luke chapter 4, verses 1 through 13, we have the account and where Jesus was in the wilderness of Judea and he was tempted three different ways. The first temptation was the invitation to use his miraculous power to serve himself. If he had accepted that invitation to turn stones into bread, that would have been his first recorded miracle. But he refused. And refusing to turn stones into a bread after a 40-day feast doesn't look like a sin, at least not a big one. But Jesus saw something wrong with it. Was it a matter of using his miraculous powers for his own comfort? Maybe. Was it a matter of just not wanting to do anything that would really or symbolically suggest that he was doing what Satan wanted him to do? Possibly, who knows? We do know he resisted that temptation. The second one in Luke was the invitation was to worship Satan in exchange for world domination. And again he refused. Even though if Satan could have delivered on his offer, Jesus could rule the kingdoms of the world without having to go to a cross. And then the third, he was challenged to show that he really was God's son by provoking God to send angels to keep him from hurting himself. I see lots and lots of symbolism and practical meaning and lessons in these three temptations.
This
was the moment when Jesus was setting the direction of his life. If he made good decisions here, everything else would be that much easier. Not easy, but that much easier. If he made bad decisions here, getting back on track would be that much harder. Jesus is demonstrating here, right at the beginning of his ministry, the importance of getting started in the right direction. There's a basic three-step process that I find to be very useful in serving God faithfully. Step number one, decide to do God's will. Step number two, figure out what God's will is. And step number three, do God's will. But step number one is the critical one. Decide to do God's will. Whatever it is, deciding to do God's will, whatever it is the decision that determines the value system on which we will do everything else and decide everything else. We decide up front, that's what I'm going to do, and then we figure out what he wants us to do all through life. If we compromise our values at the beginning, thinking that we can work things out later, it seldom happens. A person can do unethical things in order to get a job, in order to get a promotion, thinking that once he has the job or once he has the promotion, then he will be in a better position to accomplish more good. But by compromising earlier, he loses credibility for taking a stand later. And if he compromises early and gets away with it, he weakens his desire to do the right thing later. If we want to do right later, we have to practice doing right now. We need to make sure that our early decisions are consistent with and contribute to the godly goals that we claim to have for our future. So we have this three-part process here at the beginning of the ministry of Jesus. There was his baptism, there was the affirmation by his Father, and there was his faithfulness when tempted. Together, these three events formed the starting point and the turning point that got his ministry off to a good start on a solid foundation. The big event that I want to look second, the second big event that I want to look at was the selection of the 12 apostles. We read about this moment in Luke chapter 6. This occurred somewhere in the early part of his three-year ministry. And unlike the start of his ministry, which I've just presented as a three-event combination, this was pretty much a single event. He spent an entire night in prayer, and then from among all of his faithful disciples, he chose 12 and called them apostles. These 12 were to be his special messengers to the world. Luke 6, verses 12 and 13. Now it came to pass in those days that he went out to the mountain to pray and continued all night in prayer to God. And when it was day, he called his disciples to himself, and from them he chose 12, whom he also named apostles. Why was this such a turning point? These were the 12 men with whom Jesus would spend more time and devote more training than anyone else. Jesus would entrust these 12 with a task unlike that given to anyone else. On these 12 men, the founding and the future of the church depended. It wouldn't matter what Jesus did or accomplished. If these 12 didn't do their job, the plan would fail. How many founders of businesses or of churches can never quite bring themselves to passing the baton on to the next generation? They just can't trust others with their creation. Well, that is what Jesus was doing when he chose the 12. They were the ones to whom he would hand over his church. Selecting these men was a major event in the life of Jesus. One of the last things that Jesus did before he was crucified was to pray for these 12 men. Just a couple of verses, be better to read the entire prayer of Jesus in John 17, but we'll read just a couple of verses that show how much he was counting on them as revealed by what he prayed to God about them. In John 17, verse 18, "As you sent me into the world, I also have sent them into the world." He's talking here about the 12, not about others, about the 12. And then in verse 20, "I do not pray for these alone," that is the 12, "but also for those who will believe in me through their word." He was counting on them. Acts 1 verse 8 reinforces the idea when he's speaking to the 12 and he says, "But you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth." Jesus was counting on this group. This was his first string, and there were no reserves. We know later that they replaced Judas with Matthias. But even then, it was this group who recognized the problem and addressed the problem. The next turning point to study tonight is another multi-phase process that I will call peak and decline. This is a group of events that all occurred at about the same time, possibly even within just a week or two, or maybe days of each other. Now, we know that chronology in the Gospels is always a challenge. Fitting all the events together and getting them in the exact order is probably impossible. So we can't be sure of the exact order of these events I'm going to mention, but it is pretty clear that they all occurred at about the same time. And together, they represented a peak moment in the ministry of Jesus, as well as the start of what looked like a decline in his ministry. All four of the Gospels include some or all of this series of events. In this, we have the miraculous feeding of the 5,000, and shortly after that, the miraculous feeding of the 4,000. There is also the miracle of Jesus walking on water, which had made a tremendous impression on the disciples who saw it. These miracles brought his popularity to a peak, so much so that the crowds wanted to make him their king right then and there. This happens right after the feeding of the 5,000. John chapter 6, 14 and 15. Then those men, when they had seen the sign that Jesus did, referring to the feeding of the 5,000, said, "This is truly the prophet who is to come into the world." Therefore, when Jesus perceived that they were about to come and take him, and by force to make him king, he departed again to the mountain by himself alone. Then, seizing the opportunity provided by this peak of popularity, Jesus taught some lessons that were more challenging to the audience than what he had been presenting up to this point. And the result being that a fair number of his disciples turned away, left him, backed off. John chapter 6, verse 66. From that time, many of his disciples went back and walked with him no more. All by itself, this is the turning point. Jesus saw that the time had come to sort out the true believers from the curious onlookers. Now, he could have done this differently. Oh, I'm really popular. I've got them going right now. And just give them a lot of fluff to keep them coming and build it more. He went the other direction. He sorted out these curious onlookers from the real seekers. And when you lose a lot of your followers, that can cause some doubts, some hesitation, some questioning, even if you expected it to happen. But there was more involved here than just a couple super miracles followed by some demanding teachings. The events of Luke chapter 9 seem to have occurred at about the same time as the events that I've just described in John chapter 6. In Luke 9, we read about the feeding of the 5,000 as well, which shows us that these events are at about the same time. This is when Jesus asked his closest disciples who they really thought he was, and he must have been really pleased to hear Peter say, "You are the Christ of God." And then Jesus followed that declaration by mentioning for the very first time that he was going to be crucified. He followed that by telling his disciples that cross-bearing would be a metaphor for following him. In Luke chapter 9, verses 20 through 23, he said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Peter answered and said, "The Christ of God." And he strictly warned them and commanded them tell this to no one, saying, "The Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and be raised the third day." Then he said to them all, "If anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me." It's not surprising that some of the disciples turned back. They had gone suddenly from picnics on the lawn to carrying crosses. They had gone from seeing this man as a king and them as his royal court to dying to self. This was truly a turning point in his ministry. Until this moment, Jesus had been building his ministry. Everything was growing. Everything was looking good. For many people, that idea of an earthly kingdom was almost in reach. They could see it forming. And then all of a sudden, Jesus shifted gears and talked about crosses and sacrifices. His whole ministry took a different tone from this moment forward. And if you want to do the exercise, go back, pick any of the Gospels and read through them, and you read to this moment, and then take note of this moment and see the tone that changes in the story from there on. So the final event of this phase is extremely important because of the events it sets in motion. The transfiguration. That was just what Jesus needed in order to enter this final phase that would end at the cross. Transfiguration is a little bit like the baptism. The baptism started the first phase of his ministry, and God encouraged him at his baptism by voicing his approval from heaven. And he does the same thing here at the transfiguration to encourage Jesus as he enters this final and most difficult phase. Jesus, Peter, James, and John go up on a mountain. There they have a vision of Jesus speaking with Moses and Elijah. Peter suggests that they should build shelters to honor all three of these men. And God corrects him by saying, "This is my beloved Son. Hear him." Now, Peter, James, and John were certainly impressed by all of that. But let's not overlook what Jesus might have felt when he heard that voice. He had just driven or would soon drive many followers away by making some tough discipleship demands. But they had to be made. He couldn't avoid it. And the cross was getting closer and closer. So by a combination of spectacular miracles, tough teachings, announcement of a coming crucifixion, a stunning resurrection, and a reaffirmation from God, the ministry of Jesus was now ready for that crucial home stretch. In a sense, the life of Jesus is a straight line. There was never a doubt that the boy born to the virgin would die on the cross. But on a more human level, there were milestones and turning points. If Jesus was tempted in all points such as we are, as we're told in the book of Hebrews, then he could have made wrong choices. He could have turned the stones to bread. And who knows what difference that would have made. Jesus knew the thrill of speaking to huge crowds. He knew the frustration of seeing people walk away just shaking their heads. He knew that one of those 12 men would betray him and another would deny him. But he drew encouragement from faithful disciples, and he was encouraged by the words of affirmation from his Father. Some of our turning points are the result of decisions we make. Others are inflicted on us and call for us to respond with good decisions. We need to follow the example of Jesus by choosing the right path to begin with and then staying on that path, and we'll do pretty well. If you need to make your decision for Christ, do it tonight. And if you've gotten off track, don't waste time. Get back on immediately. If we can help you, let us know. Let's stand. Let's sing.